There's a lot of faces in the Zoom meetings that I don't always recognize, although with my business, I see a lot of people through my repairs, and they're all just emails, so not always faces. So it's great to always see people and connect in one way or another, whether through meetings or through emails. So excellent. Announcements I missed. So 50-50 draw. We've got the 50-50. Oh, there's a guy.
Oh, yeah.
Don't want to forget that. So do you want to explain it?
I will.
Yeah.
I'll just get up front here so everybody can take a really good look.
50-50, John.
I have to move the section these days. Yeah. Anyway, we have our 50-50 draw. I'm not sure exactly when we're going to have it. We will. And we need your money. All this money, of course, goes to the club. Those of you who aren't familiar with it, you get three raffle tickets for $5. I defy anybody to find a bargain that's better than that.
Don. Oh, well, okay, it doesn't matter too much, but the camera's over here.
Oh, okay. Technically, the Zoom people can't really get
involved.
No, wait a second. Don't you dare rule us out. I mean, we can commit to a certain number of American dollars and then send it to whomever, win or lose.
Okay, can anybody quickly send e-transfers to you or like on the spot?
Oh, they just send me whatever they want. Here it's American or Deutsche.
Take money. E-transfers in the next 20 minutes and you'll be added in. And
we'll Hi, folks. Hey, nice to see this crowd out here. I just see multiples of Mr. Lollier here. So they're three for $5. It's a deal. And you get half the take. So it's a 50-50. So we get $60 in here.
I win.
That's right. And I take my commission. So it's always it's fine. So at a certain point, when we think you're getting ready to bid on things, perhaps, get your tickets.
Yep. Okay. Get your tickets. Right. And what we'll do is take American dollars from our American friends and we'll pay you in Canadian dollars. How does that sound?
Right. That works.
We're not really working together, are we?
Okay. One more announcement for myself. I know one thing my dad used to do as a gramophone doctor is he would bring in needles for people in the meetings, which I haven't been doing, but I did today, and I probably will try to do for other meetings, but anybody that's here, if you want steel needles, I do have some if you want to buy some, and you can get me later.
Yeah, so, okay. I guess you could send them to people as well.
My own customers, $3 is basically all I charge for shipping for about 5 packs, depending on the phone because of weight, but I will ship needles and I supply needles to anybody that needs
very soft, good
medium loud tone.
Yeah. Great.
So on to the next. Okay, so then we've got Don, I believe, Don Colvin.
Yep.
So Don Colvin is
right here. I'm on Zoom.
Yep. Okay. I'm gonna put you on. So just and you're gonna talk about technology, the golden age of
technology.
Well, it's a discussion forum. I'm not really going to talk about it as much as present a thought out there and get your feedback.
All right. Hang on.
Try and get some participation.
Exactly.
Click anywhere on your picture.
So having said that, this segment each meeting is really meant for people who are new to collecting and get kind of an overview from those of you who are super experts, which is most of you, and just to be fun and interactive and give us some perspective and thought on these issues. So today, I was thinking, you know, we have the golden age of Hollywood. We have the golden age of singing. Is there a golden age of the phonograph? So the milestones, just quickly, acoustic cylinders. So for vocal historians, this would be a bit of a golden age because there's a belief that that is the truest recording of a voice. When somebody stood in front of a horn, sang into it, and you played it back. So those recordings, like the Mapleson cylinders, are valuable to historians because we actually can hear precisely what the person sounded like. Then there's the blue amberols, which I must confess I spend more evenings than I should sitting around listening to my collection of blue amberols, which sound just as good now as they did when they were made. Then the orthophonic, was that the golden age? They sound pretty good, those machines. I don't think you've ever really heard Elvis until you've heard an Elvis 78 on a tube amplifier. It really is a completely different sound. The 80s, was that the golden age? We certainly had a lot of technology. We had solid state. Everybody had entertainment centers, if not complete rooms devoted to it. Digital CDs, was that the golden age? We certainly were told by way of the 1812 Overture being played in every record store at an incredible volume so that you could hear how perfect digital recording was. Maybe that was the golden age. Maybe it's just the horn speaker. I'm a big fan of musicals, and I have to say, listening to a musical overture on my Victor external horn sounds pretty much like being in the theater. So maybe that's the golden age. Anyway, somebody weigh in. What do you think?
My opinion, which is got to be tempered by the fact that by trade, I'm a computer consultant, or at least I was for decades, more than I would like to admit. Having as a relative newcomer, since only been collecting since 1988, I would say that in my opinion, golden age is probably 1900 to about 1930, which would include many of the different genres that you just mentioned, including acoustic, standing in front of a horn for both cylinders and flat records, because that's how they did it back then also. The question is our ears and what we like when we look at it. My collecting has been mostly towards cylinder machines, mostly 2 minute. I've got some 4 minute, and I have, after 12 years of looking, a BF with a 2 and 4 minute adapter top on its way to me. To further support that, I would say that, again, it's each of our own opinions. I don't know if you can really specifically label a golden age. I would say that a golden age generally has to do with something old, as a golden anniversary, et cetera, and so on. So for me, golden age is 1900 to 1929, 1930, starting with everybody and ending with the demise of the Edison Record Company and its productions, for whatever the reasons were. And I'm not sure if I've shared with you the letter that I have, but if you'll let me know, and if I haven't, I have the letter that was put out by the Edison Phonograph Company regarding why they were shutting down and when that was going to happen. Let me know, and I'll share it.
That sounds great. I would like to see the letter. Anybody else want to weigh in on this?
Well, I could add something. Do I have to go?
Yeah, no. Me too. No, you're okay. Just speak up.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. I'm Paul Doddington. I've been in this hobby since 1948.
Whoa.
Long time. And I have fine-tuned things down to the point where I agree that it's that period. It's in that early period. But I think the finest recordings made during that period, the most lifelike, were made on the first series of Edison Blue Amberol records that came out at the end of 1912, and which were discontinued in the end of 1914 because they started making what people have called damberols, because they were dubbing the things and they sounded like hell. They don't sound good. As a musician, I like the early ones. Edison had gone through a period of refining his recording process. He was using viscous damping on his diaphragms. You can hear the people breathing on these cylinders, and you can hear all the sibilance. The high frequencies are all there, and they're all reproduced back. And the interesting thing that I found was that the much vaunted opera machine but not play them as well, it's a triumph, because the opera machine has three 90-degree bends, and one is right in the reproducer, and then there are two after that before it gets to the horn. And if you know anything about plumbing, 90-degree bends are not good things to have. The opera machine, or the my Triumph machine, which has Music Master horn, has much larger curves in the horn. It's not all squat. There are no 90-degree bends. The sound comes directly out of the diaphragm and immediately starts into an exponentially expanding shape. So the high frequencies are better on a Triumph if you can get the motor to run as nicely as an opera does. But operas have flutter, which is very difficult to get rid of because they're driven by a little piece of piano wire in one of the flywheels. And years ago, I took the piece of wire out to see what the effect would be. And motor noise, accelerating and decelerating, the spur gears was transferred to the cylinder. So I realized that this is a clever way of damping that out. But not only does it damp it out, but if the lubrication isn't exactly right on an opera, it won't play absolutely perfectly in the tune. But a Triumph will. You have to work on that too. So anyway, I think the best period anyway for sound recordings was that period right there. So that's my
excellent.
Yeah.
Thank you. Very good explanation.
That's great. Yeah. Thanks, Paul.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I guess I would put a similar period, probably 1900 to 1912, as being the golden age, because before that, this technology or recorded music had not been available to the masses. So the golden age to me is surely the introduction of it and the massive growth of the industry and the availability of recorded music for everybody during that early period, where you went from brown wax cylinders that really didn't play very well, all the way through to blue amberols that played twice as long and much better. And of course, by 1912, you also had 12-inch, 10-inch discs, 12-inch discs, double-sided discs. So whatever your taste, there was a music machine and a format available for you. Since then, if you think about it all the way through history, we've only had improvements on improvements on improvements, which is wonderful because that's exactly what happened in that early period. But it also continued long after that. But surely the beginning of it was the most exciting period. Just imagine never having had access to recorded sound and having had the control of it yourself to put a record on and play it and to play it again and to play another one and to buy more. I mean, the control and the power that you had as an individual was massive. I mean, that's almost the equivalent of the smartphone today. So there's my two cents.
Good point.
Canadian or American?
we don't have 2 cents here anymore, so it'd have to be American.
You can have, you know what? You can have all of ours. I'll send them to you.
Anyone else weighing in?
In the broadcast industry, music was played on radio stations, typically out of on 78s via gramophones. But in 1928, RCA Victor came up with the transcription broadcaster table. And those were on 33 1/3. And the audio quality was amazingly well done.
I think that's true of most of these machines, is that when I play a record, I still am kind of mesmerized that it works. And not only does it works really well. Like I say, I could spend an evening listening to Blue Amberols quite happily. And the bit of surface noise I find rather comforting, not upsetting at all. And the sound is terrific, and those things are 100 years old. Anyone else?
Here, I'll say something. I agree with Mike Bryan about like, but a lot of it is just the music I like. Like I like the really early Grand Prize Victor records, you know, up to 1913 and before that, before 1908 even, before the Grand Prize came out. Well, I think a lot of it just depends on the genre a person likes, but just a few days ago or last week, I sold a bunch of my old, a lot of 78s from the 50s and 40s that I collected years ago, rock and roll and doo-wop and things like that, because I met a young fellow, 25, from Prince Albert, and he started a few years ago rebuilding and restoring jukeboxes, and he plays, you know, that kind of rockabilly music and all that stuff. So I had all these records, and he's even like, you know, he's learned how to fix tube amps and recone speakers and all that stuff. So it was really great to find a young guy who likes this stuff. So some of the records I had, like one, the Bobettes on Atlantic, Mr. Lee, I saw that on Discogs, you know, it sold for $44 US. And so all these records I have that were like mint or near mint just played beautifully, even though I didn't have a tube amp, but I've got a good setup. So I just sold them all to him for like $3 each, you know, just because I was happy to have a young guy, you know, into it. And I told him if he turns around and sells them for big dollars tomorrow, that would be fine with me too. You know, he's going to use the money to spend to buy more gramophones or jukeboxes. But yeah, and what Don said about the sound from those 78s, because of some of that music I have on 33s as well, that were like reissues or whatever, and they don't sound as good. The 78s were really amazing. And the night before he came over, I played some, and it was so good. I thought to myself, oh, should I sell this? I said, well, I haven't listened to it for years, you know, so I hardly paid anything for them. Back 30 years ago, I was buying boxes of 78s for $10. And so I was happy to pass them on to a young guy.
Yeah, it's great that young people are taking interest. And I agree with you totally, Tom. It was actually my younger brother, who's also a CAPS member, who fixed an electric console and put on an Elvis 78. And sadly, I'm old enough to remember exactly what he sounded like. And that record sounded like Elvis. And I have lots of 33 and a third, and they sound good, and it's obviously Elvis, but it did not sound like that, which of course prompted me to go out and buy a tube gramophone, because that's what you do.
What's next?
Yep.
Okay, thank you all. That was
Then we've got this new idea of Steve's.
Okay, so it was a new suggestion for a new topic from, I believe, Steve. We're calling it I Need A. And it's basically, if you want to speak up, if there's something specific you need, it could be whether parts related, if you need something parts, even so much as I need needles. Just anything you're looking for. If you're looking for a specific collectible, maybe a specific title of a record.
Can I say something? Hello?
Hello?
Yeah,
can I? I'm looking just for a rare 16 and two-third RPM Vox album by the name of Piano Concertos.
Okay.
1958.
Okay, excellent. Yeah.
I show that, it's in the magazine, on CAPS magazine. It shows exactly what the album looks like. And every time we have the Zoom meeting, I always specify in the box here of comments, letting everybody know what I'm looking for.
Okay, excellent.
There's like 8 of these Vox albums. I was able to find almost all of them, but I'm only missing VXL6.
It's that one left, huh?
Yes. That's it.
All right, hopefully you can find that. So
I hope so too.
Yeah, anybody else have a?
Yeah, I've got a couple. I just need to look at my list, actually.
I need a need my list.
No, actually, I need a set of original listening tubes for an early phonograph.
Okay.
So
those exactly again.
So listening tubes. You know, the rubber things that with the little bits that you with a Y here and the bits you plug in your ears. So if anybody has listening tubes, this is Mike Bryan and that's what he needs.
Do you mean listening tubes that are not petrified?
Yes, that are not petrified. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I'd like them to have a little bit of flexibility, but I would like them to be original.
Hello?
And
I've got a rubber.
Have you?
But I don't have a Y. I have one, but it's a machine.
Ah, okay. That might be a start. I'll talk to you afterwards, Paul. Yeah, okay. Thank you. Thank you. And last time I did a short presentation on talking book records, the Emerson talking book records from 1918-1919. And I think I mentioned at the time that I did need some, but I'll do it formally within this segment and say that I'm looking for talking book records called The Choir Boy, The Victory Book, The Battle of the Marne, and Santa Claus and the Holly Kids. So if anybody ever comes across those, I would happily pay for them.
Excellent.
Okay, okay. Thank you.
That was your...
That's it, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
For myself, I don't have any specific needs, but as a person that repairs phonographs quite extensively, I'm always looking for parts. I always hate when people say, well, I might be throwing this thing out if no one wants it. So, I mean, it's hard to pay for shipping on a small box of a tone arm I may not use, but hey, if you have something you're not using, anybody from out west, anywhere, let me know. And if it's something I might be interested in, I might just take it off your hands.
I have two requests.
Yeah.
The first one is for a Columbia AJ3rd type, the horn support for the traveling arm. I have a repro. I would love an original. And any of the 12-inch Edison long play records. I'll take any of them. Doesn't matter which one. I just want to have one.
Okay. So Edison 12-inch long play?
Yeah, I've got the first six of the 10-inch. The 7 and 8 I have never seen even on eBay.
I'm assuming it's something that's not very common.
Well, considering long plays records were only made for a couple of years and good luck finding a long play machine, I have to repair mine. But yeah, they are very uncommon. Sort of like any other more unusual titles or Berliners.
Okay. And sorry, your name again?
I can't see who's speaking, I'm afraid. I'll try and put you on the screen.
David Hanser, H-A-N-S-E-R, Sunrise, Florida.
Okay.
Let's just get back to you, David.
It's okay. My face could scare people.
They need a break from mine.
But I love your beard.
Thank you.
I think Don wants to speak, but he's muted.
I've just recently acquired my first Pathé Actuel with the the sort of the speaker cone diffuser, they call them, for amplifying the sound waves.
I hate you.
Well, I got it home, and although it was demonstrated to me and it didn't play very well, I knew I was going to be able to do the tweaking necessary to get it playing well. For example, the fellow had the needle touching the record at 45 degrees laterally, so that was halfway between vertical.
I need to unmute this one, don't I?
Yeah. I thought I'd be able to fix it, but when I got it home and had a look at it, somehow in the transition, the little 080 screw at the center of the diffuser cone had come out. And additionally, there's a sound transmission rod that connects to the center of the horn that the end 3 or 4 inches of that is missing. I can make it better, I think, but I can make another one, I think, but I don't have an original one to use as a pattern for that. It would be... if anybody has that machine, it would be inclined to take a couple of close-up photos of that portion of the mechanism. It would really help. Or even if they had a bucket of junked parts from such a machine, I would consider using an original part as opposed to one that I would make up. Functionally, I think they might be the same. In fact, if it's anything like the one I've got where I can actually see rust on it because it was a steel rod that connects the status bar to the cone horn, it probably is due to be replaced anyway. So if you have that, the other little thing that I'm missing would be a gold-plated needle cup. It happens to be the one with the cover on it. It has two little holes for the sapphire and the diamond styluses. If you happen to have one of those available, I'd love to hear about that. Thank you. You can just send me a chat message if you've got any of those things, and I'll get it from you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Great.
I know those are rare machines too, or not easy to come by.
I have a request.
Yes.
Paul Doddington. I have a Columbia BC, one of the rare models that has 2 and 4 minute capability. So it must have come out the last year, which is, I think, 1908, perhaps. It works. This machine actually plays. It has a monstrous brass horn on the thing, just huge. It's about 5 feet long, heavy. Seen one of the ads, I can see it with a fellow in London that repairs horns. Anyway, what I'm looking for are the 2 slotted plates that go on the top of the cabinet, either side of the bed plate, and the lid hooks go down through these slotted plates. And I know they were used on other large Columbia machines, so they can't be all that scarce, but I could make them, but I would rather get real ones if I can. So that's what I'm looking for.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I have a BF and a BE. Are those slotted plates similar? Because I could send you images and measurements should you wish.
They probably would be.
Well, DM me and we can work that out.
Who is speaking?
Oh, sorry, David Hanser.
It's David again, right?
Oh, okay.
David,
yeah. Yeah.
The Columbia Graffinoli guy.
There we go.
Right. Okay. Right. Yes.
All
right. Okay.
Yes.
Something that would help a lot for those of us who can possibly never make it to a CAPS meeting, as we're a little bit distance away. I know this is going to sound ridiculous and you're all going to laugh at me, but to have nice large signs on your chest so we could know who we are looking at and talking with. You know, hung around your neck with a string.
Good practice. Okay, so I will just introduce Bill Pratt, who almost everybody knows. I don't even want to say probably how long you've been doing things, but treasurer and in charge of the website, jack of all trades with the club, but going to do some talk about the CAP project, the Canadian Antique Phonograph project, and all that was a project.
I'll be brief. Every year I update the password, as you know, for member access to the membership directory and all the magazines from the website. And I'm sure most of you have gathered the pattern. What I do is I take a Canadian phonograph brand and or a Canadian record label and then just use the current year. But this year I decided to use a Canadian phonograph brand that I posted to Keith Wright's pages, CAP, and the Canadian Antique Phonograph Project. And Mike DiCecco suggested that it might be an interesting idea to reintroduce you to his website and then put in a plea for you to help add more pages to his website. So in 2003, we had a presentation here at Centennial by a fellow by the name of Lloyd Swackhammer, a name you're not likely to forget. He was a radio expert, and the title of his presentation was Radios in Canada. He had written a pictorial book on all of the makes and models of Canadian-made radios. His collection, some of his collection is on display at the Hammond Radio Museum in Guelph. I've never been there, but perhaps some of you have. Lloyd died in 2014 at the age of 94. But at the presentation, at the end of his presentation, he threw down a gauntlet to CAPS and he said, why aren't you guys doing something similar to what I've done with radios? Why aren't you guys gathering information about all of the various Canadian phonograph brands and writing a book and creating a database. Excellent idea. And Keith Wright, he let it sort of simmer in his head for a while. And then in 2008, out of the blue, he didn't let any of us know, but out of the blue, he called me or he emailed me and he said, would you add a link on the CAPS website to my new site, CAP, which is a database of Canadian phonographs. Can you just scroll down?
Yes, I was just waiting there, until you right got there, to yeah. it. Yeah.
So I said, absolutely, I'll add a link. And instead of just adding a link, I decided to add a link to each of the pages on his site. So from the CAPS website, you can go immediately to any of these Canadian phonograph pages. So Mike's just gone to one here. Which one was that,
Mike? Amphion, just Amphion. The first one.
Just as an example. So Keith's goal wasn't to be a definitive history. It would be an enormous time-consuming project to research every single one of these Canadian machine brands. So what he decided to do was, he calls it a repository of information on Canadian-made phonographs, gramophones, and talking machines, or those machines exclusively made available in Canada. So it's a pictorial database more than anything. And what he, where he got these, in his travels, he takes a camera and he will photograph a nice example of a machine or a Canadian branded machine that is not part of his page. If you could just click on the title there now. So the Canadian, yeah. So that takes us to Keith's actual index page. So from here, you can also get to all of his pages. With the blessing of his wife Cheryl and his daughter Kira, I've now brought this entirely into CAPS, divorced from his site in case they decide not to pay for their server one year and we'll lose all of this information. So it's now all within CAPS, but I left his design exactly as he intended it. So Keith wrote a few excellent histories of Canadian phonographs. He documented Donalda, Fonola, Stewart, and Curtis Aranola. If you just go to Fonola, Mike, for a second. So this page has a lot more pictures and a lot more information than his actual documentation of the brand. If you go up to the top, there's a link there. He published his Fonola information in the CAPS website. So they really work hand in hand. If we document each of these machines, we can have an article and we can have a presentation at the meeting, and then his site will give you more pictures and more information. I added a couple brands in the last few years. I added Bell and Gourlay. But most of the other entries are really minimal information. We still need someone to write the comprehensive and definitive history of these machines. So what can you do to help? In your travels, if you see machines that are not part of the CAP site, please take photographs and send them to me, and I'll create new pages. And if you see unique examples of some of these phonographs or examples of machines in really fine condition or unusual examples, send them to me as well, and I'll add them to the site. When he started in 2008, there were between 25 and 30. We're now up to 55 unique brands on the site.
Actually, that's quite something, Bill, because there's a very good American website where somebody has, I can't remember the guy's name, but he's put together a list of over 250. And if you think 250 in the States, but yes. We're already at 50 something here.
Yeah.
we are well ahead of the game in a way.
So. I'd especially like to hear from members on Zoom of Eastern Canada and Western Canada. I mean, this is very Ontario, Quebec centered, but I'm sure you have brands out there that we in Toronto have never heard about. Yeah. Please, probably in your collections, and perhaps even quite common out there, but uncommon to us. So please take pictures and just please send them to me. info@capsnews.org. You know my email address by now.
Because this type of generic machine stayed quite local. I mean, the machines we find in southwestern Ontario are exactly where they were made. And some of them probably didn't go much further. They were made in a factory that was already in the furniture or piano cabinet making business, and they just decided to jump on the bandwagon and produce some machines with generic parts. They had the woodworking expertise, but they bought in generic parts from the States and just put them together. And whilst the boom, it depended when they jumped on the bandwagon, because if they got on in 1916 or 17, as when many did, after the expiration of some of the big three's patents, then they probably did quite well. But if they jumped on the bandwagon in 1923, it was petering out at that point, and electricity was taking over, and all sorts of changes were going on. So some of them would have been very short-lived, and others, depending on their timing and their degree of involvement, would have lasted much longer. And I mean, the names we know, like the Fonola, which was a company that continued for many, many years under different guises in the end, but there's a well-documented history that, as Bill says, with some of them, we looked them up and there's just nothing there. They weren't a company. They didn't even mention the company. It's just a brand name on a phonograph, and there's nothing to dig at, is there?
There are two that I came across that were done in Edmonton, Alberta. Oh. And again, there's really very short-lived.
Well.
Please send them to me. Send me photographs.
I shall do.
You can see the kind of thing that, you know, just photos, any little bit of information, the logo itself that we're looking at on the screens now, all that kind of thing would just get them into the system, and then other people may find more, and then we can add to it. But that would be great. Thank you, Don.
So any questions, comments, suggestions?
Well, I have an interesting comment to make based upon what you just said. This is David Hanser, sorry. Based upon what you just said, I took it upon myself to type in a list of phonograph manufacturers in the United States. And they said it's a dynamic list. You can help by adding missing items with reliable sources. And there's one gigantic, enormous item that's missing on this list. And the Edison company is not on the list. So beware of lists. That's all I have to say.
Well, so Edison who?
Yeah, exactly. That would have been Edison, John, Columbia, Victor.
So disc playing machines only and phonographs are not accepted for us.
Well, wait a second. Edison made some disc machines.
Oh, at the very end. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely
right. I know, because I've got three of them. Yeah. And they're all different.
Just sort of one last thing. I'm recording the attendance here in real time after my plea and my email to have more people come up to the meeting. I'm very happy to say that we're about 30 today instead of 20, which we've had for the last couple of meetings. And with about 22, 23 on Zoom, we're about 50, 55 today, which is fabulous.
Yeah. Very good. Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
I'll just boast that I brought four of them myself. This is a time off.
Driving condition.
Right? Yeah, the driving was great, but I don't know if you could turn the camera, but my kids over there, you can center him out. My son, Kyle, is in the audience today, which I'd like to...
I'll just do a quick... This might make our Zoom members a bit seasick, but I'll just do a quick Zoom round.
Come on, Kyle. Here you go. And my mom is right behind my son, Kyle. So we're almost there. Nope, that's not him. Yep. There. Oh, no. Keep going. We're almost there.
There they are.
And my mom. Yeah, so my son, Kyle. My mom behind. And hopefully someday Kyle might be the next gramophone doctor.
Oops.
Anyway.
Well, right. Okay.
Anyway, I had to center him out at some point today. So, all right. Next up.
Great.
You up next? Okay. You're going to want to step up here and then rush out the door to hide, right?
Go. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
well, I don't know about me, but I don't know. I wouldn't have brought my mom or my kid here.
I was actually going to say that because you're doing the introductions for today, but I was looking at the itinerary for today. I'm like, this is not the time I should be bringing my kid. And tell them why.
I don't know why the VP didn't read the email, but judging by our turnout today, it's a full house, so you guys are certainly looking forward to some smut, I guess. So, yes, today our presentation is Raunchy Records. Not try to stay away from the actual vulgar records that, trust me, this list would be a lot longer if we were to include those. Do you want to bring up that first picture? Yeah. First of all, I do have to give a disclaimer. You're dealing with a topic which is intended for mature audiences, and listener discretion is advised. So I want to start off with this an honorable mention to this lady. She was a music hall performer in London, England. Her name was Marie Lloyd. She did record many records, but unfortunately, she wasn't allowed to record the raunchier ones. But just to set off with something cute and fun, I'll give you an example of what she performed. This is my favorite song. She sits among the cabbages and peas. Think about it. So. And her songs were so raunchy that the city of London actually demanded that she perform them in front of council to see whether she was going to be banned. And in fact, the songs where she was performing in these venues, sometimes the venues had to have their licenses suspended over the vulgarity. So after singing here's some of her lyrics. She sits among the cabbages and peas with a pretty little peapod between her knees. She's a whiz at shelling peas. So she sits and shells with ease until the pretty little peapot filled with peas. Now, isn't that cute? So, of course, she was, because of the outcry, she was forced to sell to change the lyrics. And she did, with tongue in cheek. She changed it to, she sits among the cabbages and leeks. So yes, it's all going to be downhill from here. It's not going to be as cute, but so who do we have? Yes, let's start off with Mike D. Mike D, you've got your voice back, so I think you can present this. How's it going?
Okay. Hello, everybody. I hope you can hear me. I've been struggling with a cold and cough the last couple of weeks. I'm sorry I can't make it there physically today, but it's sure great to be able to join in via Zoom.
Yeah, we're going to talk about Cliff Edwards, I think.
Yes, we will. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So the first one on the list that we have is Cliff Ukulele Ike Edwards. Probably most of the people in this room know of Cliff Edwards and have heard his records. He's born in 1895 and really had his heyday in the 1920s. He started the whole ukulele fad of that decade. He remained active both recording in film and making records until the time of his death. Edwards appeared in over 75 films and is best known as the voice of Jiminy Cricket in the 1940 Walt Disney production Pinocchio. He was married three times, declared bankruptcy four times in the 1930s and 40s, and he was a lifelong heavy smoker, drinker, and gambler, and died penniless in 1971. In the mid-1930s, he recorded a few off-color novelty songs for under-the-counter record sales. We're going to be playing one today entitled, When I Was a Son of a Bee. You'll notice there's no swearing in the record. It's all a clever play on words, and I think he does a great job of it. This one's available on YouTube. I got a copy too. It sold quite well, and I hope you enjoy it today. So we're going to play Cliff Edwards' Ukulele Ike, When I Was a Son of a Bee.
This is the one, 001.
Yep. 01.
Well.
I had a dream last evening. It meant so much to me.
No.
Your mother was a flower. My father was a bee. I came into your garden.
I'm seeing you explore
when the next fall into the woods, but I'm not seeing you. You were the daughter of my daughter.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering.
I flew right past the pansy, although they waved me.
That's good.
You were the daughter. I was the son of a baby. We were the time where we could not be seen. Your top was golden yellow, but your bottom, it was all green. As I inhaled your fragrance, and figured I would be. But you were the daughter of a father, and I was the son of a baby. Oh, we dilly and we dally out in the summer sun. The heliotropes were flushing as they watched us at our fun. I buzzed around your petals, it filled me with such glee. When you were the daughter of a buttercup and I was the son of a bee. Your mother had been dozing amid the morning dew. When we awoke, she said, my dear, what has he done to you? So I flew back to the pansy. They were so nice to me that I became the buttercup, and you were the son of a bee.
Thank you, Mike, for that.
It's clever. Steve, we couldn't hear the sound a lot, especially in the beginning. It seems to be fading in and out. I don't know if there's anything you can do to correct that.
Okay.
Oh.
Best thing to do would be to go to YouTube and listen individually.
When the video player was on, the volume on the video player wasn't turned all the way up.
This one.
Right, I noticed that too.
Nobody,
the volume was low.
The Zoom people.
Right, how do I do that?
Next time you play a video, go to here. Mm-hmm. And click volume right there and turn it closer, right?
Oh,
that should do it.
Okay, right.
I don't know why it went down.
Yeah,
you might have to check that the next thing you play an audio thing or a video.
Okay, all right, okay.
Okay, so we're going to move on from the birds and the bees. We're going to move on to food. The next is Bessie Smith, because obviously you knew that sooner or later Bessie Smith is going to come up. So from 1925, this is Kitchen Man by Bessie Smith. And essentially it's about a rich lady who is downhearted because her personal chef will be leaving her employment. So she's going to miss certain things about him, for example, his ability to open clams. But anytime that he wants to come back, you know, she has a sugar bowl waiting for him. So, can we move on?
That's
it, Smith's record.
This one, or two.
Yes, there you go.
Door, butlers and maids galore, but one day way oh, Lord, yeah, it warms my job.
I think it's because you selected the
Was nice to bring that in. Eddie Lang played guitar and Clarence Williams on piano. Great. Next, another one of your records, Mike D. Bold Moose Jackson.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to go to Ruth Wallace first, but that's okay. Let me just get it up here. So we're going to move on to a record by Bull Moose Jackson. I did quick research on him. He was born in 1919 as Benjamin Jackson and got his nickname because someone commented that his face looked like a bull moose. So the name stuck with him. Yeah. He played saxophone in a variety of jazz and blues groups, including Lucky Malinder's orchestra in 1944 and 45. And after this, he started his own group called the Buffalo Bearcats. This record is from 1952 on King Records, and it was his biggest hit. It was actually later covered by the rock group Aerosmith in the 1970s. Bull Moose is talking about the size of a 78 RPM record, or is he talking about something else? We'll let you decide.
No.
It's called Big 10-inch Record.
Right.
Oh,
okay.
Oh, that one.
And then you can show.
Right. And just, okay. All right.
Got me strangest woman, believe me, this chick's no cinch, but I really get her going when I take out my big 10-inch record of band that plays the blues, band that plays the blues. She just loves my big 10-inch record of her favorite blues. I gave her a little pinch, but she said, now stop that driving and get out that big 10-inch record of the band that plays the blues. Well, the band that plays the blues. She did love my big 10-inch record of her favorite blues. I come her with kisses when we're in love with French, and when she gets all excited, she begs for my big 10-inch record of band that plays the blues. Well, the band that plays the blues. She just loves that big 10-inch record of her favorite blues. for smoking, and liquor just makes her flinch. Seems she just goes for nothing, except my big 10-inch record of Bandit Playing Blues. Well, the Bandit Playing Blues. She just loves my big 10-inch record of her favorite blues.
Well, Mike, thanks for that.
You're welcome. Hope you liked it.
Yeah. That was great.
Anybody else have any comments on this record? Anybody have any recollections of this record?
Yeah, I heard it on the radio. Yeah.
Where do you find these things?
Yeah, because he still has another one to come. And it's a doozy.
Can I have a couple comments?
Sure.
Please.
Okay. First of all, yeah, that was a nice, I didn't ever realize that the big 10-inch song, big record, was originally by Moose Jackson. I always thought Al Smith was the founder of that song. And that other song, too, about I'm a son of a bee, that was a good one, too. I never realized that such a song existed about being a son of a bee insect. Pretty clever, I have to say. I like both songs. I just want to let you guys know.
Thanks, Richard.
I have a party record that's in the same area, and it's, of course, Cliff Edwards. I got to look for it, and I'll try to put it on YouTube if I'm able.
When I was researching this, apparently he recorded about 4 party record type songs.
Mm-hmm.
And they were listed. I can't remember them now, but they are out there. And they're all in private labels. You won't find them on Columbia or Victor or anything like that.
Can't imagine why.
Yeah, I don't know. They sold well, though.
Okay, so I think
we're going to move on.
We're going to move on to Clara Smith from 1931. She sings a really, really sad tale of Hannah Johnson, who runs a farm. And of course, in 1931, this is right at the beginning of the Depression. And poor Hannah Johnson has had to sell a lot of things, her horse, her chickens, and this song tells about how she's had to sell something else. So, here we go.
Four times they tell me a monkey in red temper.
Because you're sharing the flag.
Let me tell you what they've done.
I got it ready.
Hannah Johnson was a lucky foundry till the Depression. Now she lost most everything. She had an awful profession. She didn't miss the cow. She didn't miss the chicken. But when she had to sell a jacket, then she raised a dicker. She didn't mind the loss of pig, no horses, no hay. The things that hurt her most, what the ever neighbors say. Old Hannah Johnson, big jacket, is on the block for sale. The way she works, that jacket, it must be tough as a whip. Every man in this county could ride it bareback and harness a house. You were safe on her jacket, long distance riding. Her jacket never tied. It would work for nothing, just as same as when I had a jump. Big jacket. If you own her and her, maybe we should pay. Big Daddy is on the block. For sale, I'm still talking about. That mule was on the block for sale.
Oh, poor woman. And poor jackass, for that matter. But we have to move on, and sorry about that. By the way, that was Clarence Williams on piano. Was that? Yeah, yes, it was.
All right.
There you go. But yes, you're right, that is the next one.
Right.
So we move back to food again, because for some reason food keeps cropping up in these songs. This one's from Bumblebee Slim. Admiral Amos Easton was his real name. He was actually a one-time performer with the Wrangling Brothers Circus. I'm sure he didn't sing these types of songs in the ring. He's visiting a young lady who has an orchard. And I'll let him explain what goes on.
Okay.
Are we in sharing mode?
No, I'm trying to do it.
And then, is it share in the bottom right?
No. And then share, but it doesn't. You seeing that? Yeah,
it's good.
Okay.
Can you close that menu?
If you got fruit in your basket, lemons on your shelf, I know good well, honey, you can't squeeze them yourself. Honey, please let me squeeze your lemon while I'm in your lonesome time. Let me squeeze your lemon, baby, until my love comes down. Honey, please don't tell me what your mama don't like. Let me squeeze your lemon anyhow. Mama, please let me squeeze your lemon while I'm in your lonesome town. Let me squeeze your lemon, mama, until my love comes down. Soon as I squeeze your lemon, baby, I'll let you alone. When your mama gets back, baby, I'll be gone. Honey, please let me squeeze your lemon while I'm in your lonesome town. Let me squeeze your lemon, mama, until my love comes down. When I knock upon your door, mama, please let me in. I'll be back, baby, to squeeze your lemon again. Honey, please let me squeeze your lemon while I'm in your lonesome town. Baby, let me squeeze your lemon until my love comes down. I roll a bird, mama, then I squeeze them again. You hold a tissue, baby, let that juice run in. Mama, please let me squeeze your lemon while I'm in your lonesome town. Let me squeeze your lemon, mama, until my love comes down.
Charming. I'm sure any Led Zeppelin fans would recognize where their lemon song came from on Zeppelin 2. Mm-hmm. Yeah, most definitely that was one of their inspirations. I think we're going to do another Mike D record. Ruth Wallace. Sorry if I got the order wrong. Before Mike.
Oh, hold on. Hold on.
Click on the word says Windows Mia.
It's on which one?
Windows Mia. There you go.
Right. Okay.
Okay, and scroll it back to the beginning.
That was nice and loud.
There's more to come. Mike D, do you still have a voice?
Yeah, somewhat. Okay. I didn't recall the song being that loud, so it'll wake everybody up if we lost anybody. So we're going to talk about Ruth Wallace. And I don't know about you, but when I'm hunting through records, I come across an awful lot of Ruth Wallace records. So she must have been pretty popular. Doing a little bit of research about her, she was born in 1920. She became a lead singer with Isham Jones and also Benny Goodman's orchestras. I didn't know that. She was a prolific writer and started finding that she got the best crowd feedback on songs that she wrote that had a risque, sexually suggestive double meaning to them. In the 1950s, she often touched on very taboo subjects, which included homosexuality and infidelity. Because of this subject matter, she had trouble finding a record company who would record her. And when she did, the records were often banned on the radio. Her solution was she started her own record company, and it was called Wallace Original Recordings. In Canada, these were pressed by Quality, sold very well, and she was nicknamed the Queen of Party Records. Over her long career, she released 44 LPs and 77 singles. The song we're going to play today, I thought was really appropriate because it fits in with the whole phonograph theme. And it's called Long Playing Daddy. And it was released in 1953 when there was a total change happening in the format for records, when the industry was trying to switch everybody from 78 RPM discs to long plays and 45s. So this song is sort of a play on the fact that a 33 RPM record is a very long playing record, and Ruth Wallace wants to have a long playing daddy just like the long playing record. So that's what it's all about. Hope you enjoy it. Take it away, Mike.
Yep. Okay. Seeing that?
Yes, we are.
I went down to the record shop to look for something pop. I took a look around, and what do you think I found? I found a long playing daddy down at the record store. I found a long playing daddy, don't want those others no more. I used to have the old fashioned kind. He used to stop, I had to start him up by giving him a wind. But with a long playing daddy, he plays all night long. Now a long playing daddy doesn't give you any rest. He's got a new bangle gadget and it really is the best. He's smooth and he's easy and he's always on the move. You get three times as much because he's always in the groove. I got a long playing daddy. He plays all night long. I had a small 45, but he was too short for me. I like my LP daddy. He's more satisfactory. Short and sweet, but grandma might have been all right. But I'm the gal who likes to be entertained all night. I got a long playing daddy. He plays long and strong. I got a long playing daddy, and now I'm really content. You never notice the wear and the tear, and I swear the needle doesn't even get bent. I used to hate that 3-minute kind, 'cause it was over too soon. mind, but with a lawn playing daddy, he plays all night long. Now believe me, girls, I never liked that old-fashioned pace, because I always had to pick it up and put it back in place. He's got a swell attachment, it's really something new. He comes to the end, he stops again, he's never really through. I got a long play daddy. He plays all night long. Now with the old kind, you gotta get up in a minute or two, but with an LP daddy, there's nothing you gotta do. He's got an automatic changer, it really is gone, man. You just turn over and you play right on. So girls, if you're lonesome and blue today, maybe what you need is a good long play. A long play and daddy plays all night long.
You know, it sounds to me like that woman, had she been called in front of the people in London at the day, she would have been executed.
She's just talking about phonograph records.
Uh-huh. You keep telling yourself that.
Yeah.
I thought it was a clever play on words.
It was wonderful.
Yeah. Thanks.
And historically accurate.
That's right.
Yes.
The War of the Speeds.
Yeah, so there's three meanings to this song.
Well, what she didn't mention was the 16-inch record.
Well, we covered the big 10-inch record. I guess Steve's going to, when Steve and I were talking about doing this, he said, well, you're going to have to do a part two. So I guess
yeah,
we can save it for that.
We've got a lot to go through. The next one, what are we going to do? Yes, briefly, we're going to go back to food. Tara Smith again. She did a lot of these great records. And this one's called Ain't Got Nobody to Grind My Coffee. Okay.
Okay.
Take it away, Mr. Orchestra Leader.
Yeah.
I think so, I can click the play again.
Yeah, I know. Thank you.
All right, Clara Smith from 1928. Unfortunately, we don't have any information on the band. Good information on other records that she has, but not that one. We're going to bring it up a little bit more to date with Chuck Berry. And Fred's going to talk to us about that.
Hi. So Chuck Berry is regarded as the father of rock and roll. He had a string of hits going back to Maybelline, Johnny B. Goode, Nadine, rock and roll music, 30 Days. And he recorded this particular song in England. He had no idea it was being recorded. He was there for just to do a show. And the thing took off incredibly. He was helped by somebody called Mary Whitehouse, who also helped vault Alice Cooper by attempting to get this record banned as well as Alice Cooper banned, and they both thanked her profusely.
Carry on.
So that was basically it, and he was very. He wasn't upset by the success of the record, his legacy went to suffer. It's hit. He was very pleased with it. And well, we can listen to it now.
Minimize this, get the record ready. It's ready.
Right.
Then go back to your meeting. And then share. It's okay. I can join like 6 months, three times a day.
You have to change the name rock and roll. We changed it to Chuck Berry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ready to go.
When I was a little bitty boy, my grandmother watched me a cute little toy. Silver bells hanging on a string. She told me it was my ding-a-ling-a-ling-o. Took me to grammar school, but I stopped off in the vestibule. Every time that bell would ring, catch me playing with my ding-a-ling-a-ling-o. You know what I heard? I hear two girls over here singing in harmony. That's all right, honey. This is a free country. Live like you want to live, baby. Yeah. Ain't nobody gonna knock it on. Mm-mm. Yeah, freedom. Yes, sir. One guy right over here singing mine, too. That's all right, brother. Yes, sir. You got a right, baby. Ain't nobody gonna bother you. Yeah. Once I was climbing the garden wall, and had a terrible fall. I fell so hard, I heard bells ring, but held on to my ding-a-ling. To those who will not sing. Yes, sir. This here song, it ain't so sad to keep. cutest little song you ever had. Those of you who will not sing, you must be praying with your own big
brings me back.
That's a classic.
I had this 45 when I was a kid. And my brother and I played this record so much, my father threw it in the garbage. So my brother went out and bought it again. But thank you. This is from a concert that he performed.
It was the only song that they ever won. It was his only number one hit.
I know, so. Yeah.
Ironically.
I think the concert was in 1972 in London, right?
Yeah.
And they released the live album. And this was.
And he was doing whatever with it. And then he was very happy.
Yeah.
He got a lot of money off that.
Yeah. He wasn't allowed to perform it on Top of the Pops. So what they did was they would play the track, and disgraced cartoonist Rolf Harris.
Oh yeah.
Stood and drew live while the song was playing. But a different part of the song, obviously, the clean version.
Yeah, he was a nice boy. Rolf Harris was really big, Australia.
Yeah.
Very, yeah.
So from that, let's move on to furniture moving.
Okay.
We're looking at file number line Claude Hopkins. Yeah, I think you had it there.
Yep.
Yeah. This lady is listening to her neighbors who may or may not be moving a piece of furniture. We'll figure it out as she's listening. Here we go.
Standing in the hallway, heard my neighbor singing. Standing in the hallway, heard my neighbor singing. Stop, never get in that way. Listen here, Papa, don't let yourself ride. Listen here, Papa, don't let yourself ride. It's nice to look at, but it ain't the right size. Need it, I like it, don't make your mama sore. Need it, I like it, don't make your mama sore. I'd really like to use it, but when it's back to the store. No use for you, tell you what I mean. No use for this, tell you what I mean. This narrow little hallway holds you halfway between.
Well, there you go. We have one more. And I think I'm saving the best to last. When was that from anyway? That was Claude Hopkins Quartet from 1947. And now we're going to listen to Harry Roy and his Bat Club Boys. Harry has a girlfriend who has a pet cat. So let's play this one.
Yeah,
good. Let's turn it up.
No.
It's quite jolly. You can get up and dance to this one.
I should hope not. Really?
How do you top that?
I was just thinking by the look of Harry Roy, I don't have a cat. But I have a round one. Oh my God.
Our rather dubious character. Shocking, disgusting. We shan't do it again. Well, we probably will. But please send your suggestions to me for anything. If you have another song to play, or another idea of presentation, please let me know. It's been fun. Thank you very much. For that.
Thank you.
Well, thank you to everybody for contributing as well.
Great music. Yeah, very good.
Thanks, Steve. Is that straight? Is that this one available on the site anymore?
Oh yeah, I'm going to do a write up, and we will.
I sound how the HTTP went by, and it's always screwed up. My algorithm for songs and things that I should download. So
I have the links to all these songs.
Yeah, that'd be great. Wouldn't mind that.
Yeah, I have the links, and I will include that in the write up.
Okay.
Yeah. And I thought today's music was horrible, but now I got to make sure in my collection I don't have anything my kids are going to find. So anyway, I think, are we?
Yeah. So what we have about 20-minute break, coffee and donuts over there, and our Zoom members can stay with us. If
so, you want to just briefly say what's here for the Zoom people? I know in the past we've kind of done a little.
Yes, I guess we could. Okay. All right. So for our Zoom audience, let's just tell you what we have on the Zoom table, on the auction table. We have a book about Chile, a very good book about Chile. Proceeds of that will go to the club. We have some records. We have a tin sign. See a record. We have tape records. We have an interesting box here, Diffley Edifone safety cylinder. So a box that cylinders came in. We have some copies of In the Groove from the American Max Society. We've got a transistor radio. We've got a Prepanola that is incomplete. We've got some Columbia records, more records. Book on pseudonyms on American records. We've got concertina here. We've got a Rollmonica. I see a Vogue record. So there are all the items in our sale. Some of them can be shipped, some of them can't be shipped. But please join us after our break here if you would like to bid on them on Zoom. So thank you all for joining us.